I got off on the wrong line.
I was trying to tell Bill I had a green line because I kept my mind, and then I forgot my notes. And I was over. Okay, we're not afraid to start out.
And we practiced. We practiced. Last night. We practiced.
Really slept. Eleanor, is yours the red one?
Yes. She's red.
Yes.
We are on. We're going to try this again. We are live, obviously.
Oh, I felt like I went away.
We are live now.
Okay, good. We're going to start over and do better. We're going to do better. If you're all praying, we're going to do better.
Please stand for it, if you're able. It is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 12 through 20. All things are lawful for me, but not all things are helpful. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be dominated by anything. Food is meant for the stomach, and the stomach for food, and God will destroy both one and the other. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. And God raised the Lord and will also raise us up by his power. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a prostitute? Never. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a prostitute becomes one body with her? For as it is written, the two will become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord becomes one spirit with him. Flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin a person commits is outside the body, but this sexually immoral person sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. May God add his blessing to the reading of his holy word.
Thank you very much, Greg. You may be seated, please. My memory did a flashback. Nick had to take Bennett out, right? When we were stationed in Germany, Jerry was in that age crack, a little bit older than Bennett, but not much. And it was my duty to take him out almost every Sunday from the chapel. And you really wonder, is this really any good? I mean, are we helping him? Are we discouraging others? And found out, that young man had a reception for scripture and Bible stories. And of course, I realized Judy was teaching at home so much as well. But that's a part of where children, isn't it? And I keep threatening Judy, if she doesn't keep straight, I'll take her out. Haven't had to yet. Haven't done that. But I don't know about you, Judy, about your feelings, but when Nick got up, I went, done that, been there, you know, type of a thing. That's cool. A couple weeks ago, we talked about the stewardship of time. You all got that straight now, right? No problem. Last week, it was a stewardship of talents. And we shared together in that. Now, this week, we're looking at the stewardship of the body, And there's a lot of places we could go with this, because we want to keep the perspective right. What we're looking at is the areas of our lives for which we are directly accountable to God. Paul the Apostle took a pretty high view of the body. He used illustrations in the scriptures from time to time about, like an athlete, type of a thing. Used the phrase of shadow boxing and all these different things as a constant reference. But Paul didn't look at the body in a way that is disproportionate or out of line. Paul did nothing to impair the functions of the body. In other words, to weaken its powers, to prostitute its base uses. Now, that word prostitute is a legitimate word here, which means to abuse or use in an improper way. So considering the relation of the body to religion, human opinion has really, well, the word here that's very accurate is oscillate, but not everyone knows what oscillate is, and I'd hate to be called on to define it myself. It just means shifting, right? One way or the other. So there's two opinions that have seemingly shifted throughout the centuries of time and even in our own lifetimes. On the one hand, some have considered the body to be the seat of sin. In other words, if I abuse my body, I am helping to bring my I'm helping to bring my sin under control. And some people have isolated themselves from all other people. Others have done some interesting and strange things if you're a student of history of this area. But sin must be dealt with the heart and the soul of the person. It, not eating for 40 days doesn't necessarily of its own bring sin under control. Going without sleep for 3 days as a type of punishment to yourself, that's not how you gain control over the sin in your life. You may have done both of those things for other reasons. Jesus himself did, but not to control sin. It was to draw close to the Lord. I just find it fascinating how Satan loves to take the truth of God and stretch it out and manipulate it, because he's a deceiver. He's a counterfeiter. So whenever Satan begins to do something another, that ought to set you off real quick. You know, if he's trying to do this, that must mean that God wants this. Just share that with you. The other extreme that concerning the body and how to deal with it is really represented by Greek religion. You see, the temples that today stand in ruins, and you've probably seen many pictures of them. The poetry that has come out of that era, the art and the devotion to the human body that came out of that period of time. I don't know. I've often wondered why art from that one period of time always represented the body as in the nude form, as a form of grace, as a form of art, as a form of beauty. It was like it was elevating the body to almost a godlike existence itself. And we also know within the Greek culture, within their temples, prostitution was a form, was a type of the worship service. It's how the temples were paid for. Well, obviously, both of these extremes are wrong. Punishing, damaging, destroying my body to overcome sin, or highlighting the body as being holy and reverent and good. You've probably seen movies where people would put a move on somebody else and say, well, God made the body, and using that as a pretext for going further in the relationship than the Word of God had authorized, encouraged, and blessed. There are two ways not to be spiritual. A natural suppression of the body will make you materialistic. Both put a disproportionate emphasis on the body. You cannot do that and be a spiritual person. The body has a purpose. It has value. It has worth. But in the context of what else is going to be and do? You see, the Christian position is that the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that is powerful. We're just the clay. That terminology is used in Scripture. We're like the clay jar. The body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. The body is the instrument of the mind. Okay, and then the body is the dwelling place of the inner person. We discover that whenever someone in our family or someone who is a close friend of ours, they die, and their body ceases to function, well, you can no longer have a conversation with them because their mind, it's somehow this connection with the body, and you can't do that communication. And so there is a connection there with the mind and the body. There's a connection with the body and the Holy Spirit. I find this fascinating. Not that God's trying to play a trick on us, but rather how we have taken that which God has made and we have tried to push it to its limits of extremity, and then wonder why we end up so confused. Well, we're going to look this morning at four principles concerning the stewardship. And I want to just basically ask four questions, okay? Number one, the body, whose is it? The body, whose is it? Well, the bottom line, folks, is the body is God's. It's Him. That's why, as far as our bodies are concerned, we owe a stewardship. We are accountable to Him for the way that we exist. You see, the body is God's because He designed it. He designed it. From ancient times, people have studied the heavenly, and yet until the modern era, they've never dared to investigate the human body. Today, it'd be hard for us to imagine the doctor that we go to says, well, I've never studied the body, but I'm here to help you. You know? But that's the way most of society has lived. They had no one to go to that was aware of the science, aware of the functions and the interactions within our bodies to keep us healthy. Centuries ago, the psalmist said, I praise you, referring to God, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. I hope that's a passage of scripture that you're extremely familiar with. It's out of Psalm 139, verse 14. I don't know what the psalmist would have said exactly if he had been aware of the science of the body that we have today. But I got an idea. He would probably say, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Think of those giants of the body, the brain, the heart, the lungs. Think of those sentinels of the body, the eyes, the ears, the nose, the throat, and the skin. Why, sentinels, they protect us, right? The skin, it's a protection. The nose lets you breathe, but keep out the... See, all these things, the purpose there is unbelievable. I couldn't help but notice on a Facebook from a friend of ours who had the COVID-19, and they've recovered from it, and they live quite a ways from here over in western Kansas. And the lady said, it feels so good to smell again. She had lost the ability to smell, and you don't give that much thought to it until you don't have it. You know? I know there have been times that I've prayed that people would lose their sense of smell because we weren't in the best shape to present ourselves. That was a joke, okay? I want you to think about the teamwork of the command and the control that's involved with our muscles and our nerves and the bones. Wow, how they interconnect. Those of us that have had that shoulder surgery, you know, we understand what it was like whenever the tendons became separated. The arm just hung. No matter what you said for it to do. I mean, the connection there is unreal. Others of you sprain your ankle or something like that. Oh, yeah, all these things. That we are fearfully and wonderfully made. We are so complex, and yet we do so much without our understanding. Think of the laboratories of the body, the stomach, the liver, the colon, the gallbladder, the pancreas, and the kidneys, all needing to work properly. You see, God designed the body. Only He could have done it. I'm sorry, that was not an accident of one cell saying, oops, I need to do this, and just suddenly magnify into something else. All this interconnectedness is truly, I praise you, Father, because we are fearfully and wonderfully made. The body is God's, not only because He designed it, but also because he created it. And in the simplest language, what we understand about this is that the creation record tells us of the true nature of man. In Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, the scripture says, "The Lord said, the Lord God formed the man," or the person, "out of dust from the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living creature." You know, what separates us from animals? The breath of God. Because we have within us the breath of God, we are we're made so much like God. We enjoy the privileges of participating in a good world with the capacities of growth and fellowship with God, because God not only created us or designed us, He created us. And the uniqueness, He breathed into us the breath of life. And you say, well, okay, I remember hearing that when I was in Sunday school, when I was a little fella. Yeah. Have you really lived like you have within you God's presence? The other thing we see is that the body is God's because He's redeemed us. He not only designed us and created us, He's redeemed us. Long ago, God spoke to His people and said, "But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." That's God's attitude towards you and me. He really loves us. Just believe God's word, and your life and your body becomes sacred. Kind of like a sacrament. It's part of God's deal. Paul the Apostle in Romans chapter 12 and verse 1 put it in a way that most of you are quite familiar with. And he said that as Christians we ought to present our bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Wow. That's that relationship that we have with Him. So the body, He designed it, He created it, and He redeemed it. All right? Secondly, the body is, what is it? What is the body? In the simplest terms, the Bible tells us that the body is a dwelling place, the house of the inner person. Different descriptions. There's places in the scripture where we're talked about. We are a tent. We're like a tent. There's a lot of passages in scripture that gives us some insight to our body. As a matter of fact, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1, Paul the Apostle tells the church at Corinth, the Corinthians, he said, we know that if the tent, that is our earthly home, is destroyed, we have a building with God, or from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. You see, the body is the dwelling place of our minds, of our rational nature. In the creation records, we're told in Genesis 1:26, God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. And so most of us think of God having ears, a nose, and hands, and feet. No. God's spirit. He's not a body. So in what ways now are we talking about here? Being created in the image of God cannot mean or refer to our body. John chapter 4, verse 24 says, God is a spirit. As far as we know from Scripture, I know he's used the description about the hand of God and all this, but no indication is there that he has those features. It must mean then that the rational and moral and spiritual nature of humans are all included in the image of God. This is one of the reasons you who are Christians here, you live for the most part in a totally different plane than the non-Christian. Because you have an awareness, whether that is a sharp awareness or just a sense of awareness, God is in me. God is spirit. He made me. There's something special going on here between me and God. Don't you understand? Those who are not Christians do not have that awareness, do not experience that connection. That's one of the reasons evangelism ought to always be on our heart and mind. The body is the dwelling place of the human spirit and soul. So we have a body, but we are a soul. Now, I know we've buried enough of our family through the years that when there is the death of the body, it grieves us greatly. And it's interesting how when we look upon the person who has died, there is such grief and pain there. But the bottom line is, we also, as Christians, understand that person is a soul. And if they're a Christian, they are with the Lord. But we understand that there's a separation from us, because our bodies are still functioning. We're still living, as it were. And our real essence is spirit. Our real essence is soul. And so there is that sense of separation there that's really difficult to comprehend, if not impossible. It's really difficult when we have to experience it. Most important for the Christian, though, is that the body is the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. John chapter 14, verse 1, or verse 17. John chapter 14, verse 17. Jesus told his disciples on the night that he was betrayed, he said this, he says, you know him because he abides with you and will be in you. Now that's the Lord speaking. That's the full impact of our text that Greg read. It says, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? That was in verse 19 of the text you read, Greg. Paul admonished to the Ephesians. He says, be filled with the Spirit in Ephesians 5:18. But the trouble is, most of the time, we're filled with something else. And so that, because that's part of that conflict that we have within ourselves. We're apt to be filled with ourselves rather than him. And the self, the biblical description is like a tent. In other words, it's a temporary dwelling place. The next question we want to ask about the body is, how should we use it? How should we use it? Here's two sides of a coin to consider. On the one hand, there are the wrong uses of the body. On the other hand, there is the faithful stewardship of the body. Well, we can say this with confidence, that whatever impairs the normal functions of our body is wrong. It's wrong. We know that the habitual use of alcohol can cause cirrhosis of the liver and damage certain parts of the brain. So why would you choose to deliberately damage your body and your mind? That's not good stewardship. No faithful steward of the body would take up a habit that causes lung cancer and emphysema and other respiratory diseases. How can any pleasure from smoking compensate for such damage that we are doing to our body? Well, I know so-and-so, they had cancer of the lungs and they never smoked a day in their life. Yep, that happens. It's not restricted. You don't have to smoke to get lung cancer. But if you do smoke, what are the odds of getting lung cancer? Higher. Higher. So they say. So they tell us. The point of it is, there are some things that we do to ourselves that violate the principles of being a good steward of that which God has given us. I'm not going to beat you up over it. That's you having to present yourself before the Father and give an answer, give a reason. Another point would be that whatever enfeebles the body's power is wrong. In other words, whatever makes it old before its time is sin. Damaging your body. Whatever prostitutes the body is wrong. By that I mean when you just... Well, it's like the... It's like the young man that left his father and went off to a far country to enjoy his inheritance, and he ended up living with the pigs. You know, when you live with pigs, you get dirty, don't you? You understand that? You don't have to get dirty if you're a pig farmer, but if you live with the pigs, you're going to get dirty. That was one of my first jobs I ever had, was working with 300 hogs. One of the first jobs I quit. Whether it's fornication or sexual impurity. these things damage the body. Well, wait, why does it damage? Why is it damaging? Because the Bible says whenever two come together, they come as one. You come as one. And to violate that does damage. Whatever permits the body to become a vehicle of uncontrolled passions is wrong. Whatever causes you to desire wrong. Once again, that prodigal son, he became a vehicle of uncontrolled passions. And he went for anything and everything that was there. He was the center of the party as long as his money held out. Don't make a mistake here. The prodigal son is dramatizing our lives. As we look at him, we ought to be able to say within ourselves, there am I. I'm that boy. But on the other hand, there are the uses of the body that God intended. We're not just to be on a shelf and just stay there. God intends that our bodies are to be used as instruments of His worship and praise. The parts of the body, the eyes, the tongue, the mind, the emotions, are all important parts to play as a part of our worship experience. Don't be afraid of the emotion. Don't be afraid of the mind. Don't be afraid of the tongue. Goodness. We're so much of Scripture talks about praising God and giving Him the glory. How many times, you know, the parts that amazes me in the Old Testament is back whenever they were reading the law to the people. Do you know what the people did for all day long? They stood. They stood in place while the law was being read to them verbally. Can you imagine that? That's anti-American. We've got to be able to sit, take breaks. I don't know how they did it, but I just noticed that's in the Scriptures that they did do it that way. In other words, evidently their body was mastered by their spirit rather than their spirit being mastered by their body. God intends that our bodies be vehicles of righteousness. Paul wrote to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 4:16, he says, our outer self is wasting away. Our inner self is being renewed day by day. We have a multi-billion dollar industry here in America that works on keeping us from looking like we're decaying as much as we are. And be honest about it, most of the time we appreciate it. But it doesn't stop it, does it? The body decays as time destroys it. Because God created us, and we were put here on this earth. He not only designed us, He created us, but for a time. For a time. You see, while we're wearing out a body, we ought to be growing a soul. Have you ever wondered why so many stories are about so-and-so was such a rascal, such a mean person, such a vicious person, and there was a life turnaround, there was an experience, and a conversion, and so many times the stories would go, that's because grandma was on her knees. You see, grandma doesn't worry about not being 20 years old anymore. She's more concerned about the soul. That's why some of those stories, though we use them to make fun or just to talk, there's a truth to that. God intends that our body be the instruments of His glory. I find it fascinating here. When Jesus arose from the dead and he appeared to the disciples and the others in the upper room, did you notice something about His hands and His feet and His side? They weren't healed. The wounds were still there. Really? Yeah. The scars. Sometimes we think of scars as being a reason for shame. I really encourage you, scars are an indication of life. Things you have done, things you have experienced, things that have happened to you. Paul used the term that I would encourage you is, he talked about the battles for Christ that left scars on His body. But he did not consider them a disgrace. To him, they were a badge of honor. What are some of the things that caused scars on Paul's body? How about having rocks thrown at you? That hurts. How about being whipped? How about being lost at sea for a while? How about, well, just go on with the list. These were not sources of dishonor to Paul, but they were sources of honor. Not that he wanted any of them, not that he created them, but they happened to him because of who he was in Christ. Galatians chapter 6, verse 17. Paul wrote to the church in Galatia. He said, henceforth, or from now on, let no man trouble me, for I bear branded on my body the marks of Jesus. Paul prayed that Christ might be magnified in his body. Some of you that teach in our children's church program, teach in Sunday school, probably didn't feel like coming this morning. You may have been tired, you may not have been feeling well, you may have other things on your calendar or whatever. But you came anyway. You taught anyway. Why? Well, for some of you, these are marks or scars on your body. You're still tired, but you did it because of the Lord Jesus and what he's done in your life. You're not ashamed. You're not afraid. You're just doing that which you know you're called to do. And the last point, real quick, is the body. What of it? What of it? What conclusion should we reach here? The supreme revelation of God was in his taking on human flesh in the person of his son. I know we love Christmas, but do you think what that means? That God, whose spirit, took on human flesh? Is that a step above or a step below? A big step below of who he is. That's one of the reasons we Christians ought to think of our bodies as sacred. God himself had his son take on the form of a human body. Jesus, our Savior, had a human body subject to all the ills and the pains that flesh deals with. That's why I've always insisted that Jesus must have had a girlfriend. Well, it says he was tempted in all points like me. And if you haven't had a girlfriend, you haven't been tempted. Is that logical? You don't get it, do you? But he didn't sin. Sometimes we excuse ourselves because we were tempted. But Jesus was tempted like we were in every way. But he didn't sin. That blows that excuse out the window. But it ought to help you to understand that's what Jesus went through on our behalf. Let no one despise your body. Don't abuse it, don't pollute it, don't defile it, and don't fail to be a steward of it. Paul wrote this to the Corinthian church. He said, so is it with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable. It's sown in dishonor. It's raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it's raised a spiritual body. If there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body. Wow! What does it mean, a spiritual body? Well, I don't know that we can really know fully what that means. I think we kind of pick around the edges. We do know that the body is the carrier of your individuality. The New Testament, in speaking of a spiritual body, says that by God's grace, we have a means by which we can be known on the other side. You know, that's one of the questions you have. If you lost a child, or mom, dad, spouse, will I know them in heaven? Will I know them? That's a question. It just keeps coming up. Will you know them? I don't have God's permission to tell you all the details on this because he hasn't told me, but the indication seems to be, yes, you will. The indication seems to be that you will. My encouragement to you is, let's not worry so much about what we're going to be like on the other side. I can just put one word there that says good. Good. Let's be more concerned about what kind of stewards we are in the here and now. Because the word steward means we will give an account to our master. What we've done with our time, what we've done with our talents, and how we have used or abused our bodies to his glory and to his praise. You see, all of life is about our relationship with God through Jesus Christ. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of doing that which you know is absolutely the right thing to do. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, my friend, there is no better time and no better place. If you believe this ought to be your church home, same thing. What's the delay? If there are burdens on your heart that you'd like to have us pray with or pray for, we as a church stand ready to do that as well. That's why we ask an elder and a wife to always come forward during the invitation hymn to be prepared to minister to you and with you. The bottom line is each of us makes a choice. And with that choice, you decide on whether you're presenting yourself before the Father as a steward or whether I'm holding on to what I want to do. Thank you, Father, for this time together. We praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go ahead and turn to our invitation hymn, and the invitation time is open. Supper. You do not have to be a member of this church. If you're you're part of the body of Christ, Jesus himself said, do this in remembrance of me. And so it's an individual act of worship, not something that somebody else does for you. So with two things here, because of what's been going on, we do have communion cups in the back that are sealed and very individual, and you're more than welcome to them. We also have a baggie with some bread in it for the communion, if that's your preference, and a wooden box back there for your offering if you choose. The reason I say that is because we will be distributing the trays for the bread and the fruit of the vine and the offering throughout the entire audience. If you prefer not to handle the trays, please just let your server understand that. Just know, just let them know, or say no thank you or something like that. It's no big deal. We're not going to make fun of you. We just wish to serve to the glory and honor of Jesus Christ. We'll be led in devotions, then in prayers, then we'll be served. God bless you. Let's sing.
Supper, it's as if we're coming to find rest. We're looking for a chance to slow down, like a sit-down meal where we are served rather than serving. The truth is, we often approach food and meals with the fast food mentality of getting and eating just as quickly as we possibly can so we can move on to the next thing. The Lord's Supper forces us to slow down, to take a seat with others, to pause and to take notice of what's been set before us. When we set our minds on Jesus, his broken body, and blood that was spilled for our sin, our souls are restored by what we have in Christ. You see, communion's not a message about what we need to do, but what's been done for us. It's not about our ability to solve our own problems. It's about God's ability and kindness to solve them for us. You see, God's word frees us from carrying the weight of the world and the weight of our spiritual walk on our own shoulders because he's carrying the weight for us. He's providing for us. He's at work in us. Any burden, any sin, any trial or weight that we might carry today, cast it on the Lord in prayer. Feel the bread in between your fingers as a physical reminder that helps you to know that God is as real as the bread in your hand. You see, I know I can trust him. I can trust him today to take with everything, to take it, to carry it, and to forgive me of my sins. Let's take time today and do this in remembrance of him.
Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for your love and goodness. You've honored us with your presence. We now wish, Father, to honor you by remembering the gracious, amazing, awesome gift you've given to us, yourself. We worship you. We praise you in Jesus' name.
Our Father in heaven, we're so thankful for this time that you give us. Lord, we just thank you for the many gifts and talents that you provide each one of us, that we better can serve you. So, Lord, we've set apart this time for us to be obedient to what God is calling each one of us to do. So, Lord, I just ask that you please bless these tithes and offerings and help to glorify you throughout this world. So we thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good to have you. I'm so thankful for the folks that stood up and helped with our children's programming and stuff, because like I say, so most of our folk are their own quarantine, which means their whole family, the Landis family. One child was in their activities, turned out to be exposed, but they don't have the disease. But good grief, can't we have smaller families be quarantined? Yvonne, the Richlers have invited anyone that would like to spend Thanksgiving lunch with them. It was lunch, wasn't it?
All day, whatever.
All
day,
oh dear, oh dear. Has anyone signed up yet? There are several that
are going to let us know.
There you go. All right.
They're making sure there's not other conflicts or plans.
That's part of life, isn't it?
It is.
Yasmin?
What's up?
You're going to goof off for a while, right?
I am.
Student at WSU, you know, they can't come back, you know, because of all this. So you said August?
Yeah.
She won't be back till August. I'm going to miss you. Yeah.
We love you.
Actually, we'll have a more peaceful church.
All right. She wasn't ready, or she would have had something rhetorical for you.
After Sunday school, we'll have our Thanksgiving lunch here at the church. Yeah. And encourage you to stay, share together. If you notice the tables, there's a certain amount of separation there that takes place, all this. So about any specific direction from the ladies? Any direction? No? Just do it, right? Okay.
I have an update on James.
Yes.
Again, I say we have an awesome God.
Amen.
Jim went to the oncologist on Wednesday, The man is totally blown away by what God has done in this man's life with his lung cancer. Again, nothing has changed. It's the same. Jim will finish out his autoimmune treatments in December, have one in January, and then he gets to decrease his visits to the oncologist to once every 4 months. And if those go well for a while, it'll be once every 6. So our good Lord deserves all the praise. This man is a tough old boot, but that's because God loves him and he's a Marine.
And next Sunday is our congregational business meeting right after church during the Sunday school hour. We're voting on 2 new men to become elders, 2 new men to become deacons, and then a couple of the guys, one elder, one deacon, to be reaffirmed. Elders serve for 3 years, deacons for 2, then they have to be reaffirmed. Okay? That's kind of the way it works. Hope your plan of come will give a full report on this past year for the church, and I hope you'll find that interesting. Anything else before we go?
Yes.
Yep. Yes, Bill.
All right. If you cannot be here, we'd like to really have you here next Sunday. There is the eligible voting list back on the foyer table. But if you cannot be, I will have the ballots for absentee ballots today. And so we'll have our voting box. We're going to use it as a dual purpose, not only for offerings, but also for our ballots that can be placed back here. So if you're on the eligible voting list, please see me right after church. So now, something else. The ones that are watching live streaming, if they would like to have a ballot that are eligible, get in touch with Greg or Jeff. They will deliver the ballot and return it here to the church. Or if you want to come by the church and vote yourself, Doug will have a few ballots to where they can vote and go ahead and place them in the ballot during the week or into the box. So anyway, that's it.
Thank you, Bill. If anyone wants to come by here and get your ballot, you see me, and all. And don't forget to bring your offering. You know, Diet Dr. Pepper would be just fine. Okay?
Let me know about poinsettias.
And yes, poinsettias. There's a lot going on right now, a lot. Poinsettias, and 2 weeks is your deadline on that one. Okay. Yeah. Anything else? God bless you. Thank you. You're very patient.
See you.
Johnny. Johnny's going to have our closing prayer and thanksgiving for our food as well. God bless you.
Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to meet here in your house this morning. Lord, thank you for the opportunity you've given us to share in your word and to share with others. Lord, I just pray that you be with those that are here, a special blessing upon them. And Father, those that couldn't be here this morning, Lord, be with them and bring them back to us. Lord, we want to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor in all that we do. Father, be with us now as we go to this fellowship time. Lord, as we meet together again, Lord, for the food we're about to receive, bless it to our bodies. It's in the precious name of Jesus that I pray. Amen.
Yes.